spiritual commandments. The actual Sufi word for these is kalman. This word commandment I would have liked to avoid, but there is no other English word in place of that or equivalent to kalmat. These are the ways through which one attains to the inner state. When one continues the maraqba or meditation, the energies that has been dissipated begins to converge. Normally our energies are scattered into many things. Each one of us wants to do this and that, and in that our energies remain scattered. As meditation deepens, the life force or Ellen White passes through various latayafs, activates these and clears the passage. When it reaches the last or the subtlety of Ruh, the soul's abode, or you can say in another words, with enlightenment, the convergence of energy attains a fruition. Now energies are no more scattered. They all have converged at one place. It is not that there are many energies. When energies pass through various latayafs, it appears as if these are emerging from different sources. These are scattered. Just imagine you are going somewhere. You have $100 in your pocket. You want to buy this, you want to buy that. And when you look at the total resources, that resources are not enough to fulfill all your requirements for various things. This is what is meant when I say that the energies remain scattered. When the energy reaches the center of Ruh, or according to Hindus, the thousand petal center, it is no more flashes. It has converged, centered in one place. This is the state of awakening. And now the awakened one, or the Sheikh, or the Master, can use this life force in myriad ways for the transformation of human consciousness. When it flows through the heart, it can also flow through eyes, vocal cord, touch. These are the various means. You can express it in the form of creativity or in any other way. The energy disseminates. When the Sufi master says that the tawajjuh of the Sheikh, that time the energy or the life force flows from a particular center. That is, the flow from that center is essential for the transformation of human consciousness. This is known as tawajjuh. When you sit down in the company of a Sheikh, whether he is speaking, whether it is a silent meditation, tawajjuh continues to flow. And once we are open to this, it creates miracles in us, brings about transformation. All the energies that have been scattered begins to converge at one place. And for this, it all depends upon the awakened one, which of these techniques he wants to use at a particular time. It was Naqshbandi Sheikh, Hazrat Ibn Khalid Ghizwani Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu, who coined the following phrase, which are now considered as the principles of Naqshbandi Sufi order, or in simple English terms as commandments. Over the period of time, certain principles were added to it. Shah Bahauddin Naqshband Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu added 3, and another, always choose to be happy, was introduced in this category as the words of another Naqshbandi Sheikh, Shakuntala Devi. Thus there are 12 such kalmat or commandments. These form the basis of meditation. These kalmats are the various stages of meditation. The first is conscious breathing or hosh dardam. We continue to live our lives like a robot in a mechanical way. We breathe, but we are not aware of breathing. There is a difference between blood circulation and breathing. Blood circulation is an unconscious effort. You cannot make it conscious. Had it been possible, then when you are angry, you will stop, the blood circulation will stop completely, or vice versa. But breathing is one thing that can be used as a conscious effort as well as unconscious. When you become conscious of your breathing, you can bring about many changes in your emotive levels. You know what happens when you are angry or when you are filled with passion. The breathing begins in a particular manner. Reversing that will help the seeker in overcoming that particular problem. Hosh dardam means mind or awareness. Hosh means you are mindful or you are aware. Dar means in and dam means breath. When you are totally conscious during the moments of your breathing, then it is known as one of the techniques of meditation, hosh dardam. Every moment you are totally aware, you are in hosh. You are not unconscious, you are not sleepy. It means, according to Abdul Khaliq Ghisdwani radhiyallahu ta'ala anhu, that he said, always safeguard your breath from heedlessness, that you are not falling in the trap of unconsciousness. The incoming and the outgoing breath, be aware of the incoming breath, outgoing breath simultaneously. This is an important technique of meditation. The entire process of meditation, Buddha's meditation, depends on watching the incoming and the outgoing breath. And Buddha called this as vipassana. Passana means to look at. When you look at something, it is known as vipassana. It is also known as anapana sati yoga, the conscious breathing. Breathing has two aspects, incoming breath and outgoing breath. And this was created to create the inner sun of awareness. Conscious breathing leads to awakening, and awakening is the key to meditation. One of the ancient most Hindu scripture is Vigyan Bhairav Tantra. This treatise is 5000 years old. In this, Devi, the consort of Hindu god of Trinity, Shiva, explains to her various techniques of meditation in response to her question. There is no philosophy in it. Devi asks many questions, and it is in a very loving atmosphere, which is known as the way of Tantra. Devi is sitting on the lap of Shiva. Lovingly she looks at him and inquires, what is this wonderful universe? What is thy reality? And questions like these she inquires. In response to these questions, Shiva gives a technique for each one of these. He could have very easily gone into the philosophy as normally happens, but he says, if you follow this technique, this kalma, this way, you will certainly get the answer to that. This is the way of the masters. Instead of giving the ready-made answers, they create the situation or give a technique using which one gets the answers to many queries. First, let us look at the breath. It has many posts. Number one, the breathing happens through the nostril. That is what we normally are aware of. Breathing happens through mouth. That's all we know about. But we do not know that we can breathe through our ears, through our skin, and every part of the body. Sometimes during the state of meditation, you experience that the breathing is happening from solar plexus or the navel center. First, let us look at the breathing through nostrils. At one moment, the breath is outside. This is the outer center. The breath is outside. Now, this is the first when the breath is outside. Then it touches your nostrils and begins the inward movement. The second part when it touches the nostrils. The third when it begins the inward movement. Now is passing through, and that process when it is entering into you through the nostrils, through the windpipe, and when it reaches the solar plexus, there is a pause for it. It is a very infinitesimal pause. Then it turns and begins the upward movement. Shiva explains in the techniques of meditation of all these stages. When the breath is outside, be aware. There is a technique which he had mentioned. Then when it touches the nostrils, when it begins the inward movement, when it reaches the last port, it pauses, takes the turn for the upward journey. All these are the various stages. Let us focus on in general, because that is the first aspect. And awakening is the key to meditation. Be centered in your heart, and thereby keeping your heart always in the divine presence. Let each breath be soaked meditatively in the remembrance of that which is. This is the Kalmar. In broad sense, the seeker begins with that. You can use a particular word for remembrance or mere. Remember, for each breath which is inhaled and exhaled consciously with presence is alive and connected with the divine presence. Because when the breath comes in, it creates a center within you, and when breath is outside, it connects you to the outer center. If I put it this way, the outer center is Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, or according to Hindus, the absolute consciousness, and the center within is Jeev or the Salik, or the microcosm. If we have to use the terminology, the macrocosm or microcosm, the outside center represents macrocosm, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, or the cosmic center, the divine center. And when the breath reaches within you, that is the micro center, microcosm, or the individual, or Jeev as Hindus call it, and then breath becomes a bridge between these two centers. You can freely move from one part, one side to another. When the breath comes into you, it is birth, and when the breath goes out and it is outside you, it is death. So breath becomes a bridge between birth and death, between microcosm and macrocosm, between individual consciousness and cosmic consciousness, between Salik and Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, or whatever way you would like to put it. Simple words, it bridges the two poles, two aspects. Remember, for every breath which is inhaled and exhaled consciously with presence is alive and connected with divine presence. And each breath inhaled and exhaled unconsciously is dead, disconnected from divine presence. Another master, Hazrat Ubaidullah Ahrar Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu, a Naqshbandi Sufi master, said, the most important mission for the seeker in order is to safeguard his breath. And he who cannot safeguard his breath, it would be said of him, he lost himself. Breath is that important. Shah Bahauddin Naqshband Razi Allah Ta'ala Unho, with whom the Naqshbandi Tariqat attained the Naqshbandi name, mentioned this order is built on breath. So it is a must for every seeker to safeguard breath in the times of inhalation and exhalation, and further to safeguard his breath in the interval between inhalation and exhalation. This is what I was mentioning to you. There is an interval, there is a gap between inhaling and exhaling. So all these aspects have to be aware of. If we focus on only one aspect, because you follow the Islamic tradition, so you will only follow the Islamic way, then why do you use electricity? Because electricity is not invented by any Islamic prophet. It was invented by a Christian scientist. We do not have any conflict as far as that is concerned. But we remain tasawwuf. We remain narrow-minded as regards to spiritual development is concerned. We feel that if we put on the Chinese clothes or Indian clothes and eat Indian food, we have abandoned our ways. It is versatility. So the inhalation, exhalation and the interval between the two. But Shiva went even further. He gave these techniques of meditation in such a minute detail that there is no technique of meditation in any system beyond that. He gave 112 techniques of meditation. Various masters have made a slight variation in one of these techniques and used it as their technique of meditation. But basically all emanated from that source. Safeguarding your breath from heedlessness will lead you to complete presence, and complete presence will lead you to complete vision. Complete vision will lead you to complete manifestation of the ultimate, or what Sufis call as Allah's 99 names or attributes. These represents various stages, or what Hindus call as 1000 names of Vishnu. Such awareness leads you to ultimate flowering of your being. Existence manifests in myriad ways. The entire existence is the extension of that cosmic energy. It is God that blossoms as flowers. It is the existence that is the cause of all that is manifest and all that is unmanifest. Sufis say Allah leads you to the manifestation of His 99 names and attributes and all His other attributes, because it is said Allah's attributes are as numerous as the breath of human being. One of the Hindu scripture Isha Upanishad says that divinity is manifest and is spread over the entire existence. Be aware of this. Life will unfold a new meaning. Remember that securing the breath from heedlessness is difficult for seekers in the beginning. Once this process begins, it continues ad infinitum. Therefore, always, as Sufis say, safeguard it by seeking forgiveness, because seeking forgiveness will purify it and sanctify it and prepare the seekers for real manifestation of Allah everywhere. I say to you, be aware and awake each moment. Never let even a single action happen unconsciously. You can be aware of your incoming and outgoing breath through practice. For this, practice Vipassana meditation given by Buddha. It is basically breath watching meditation. You need not do any ritual. The breath comes in. Otherwise, if you follow the Sufi tradition, and we make a mistake and just seek forgiveness. And then continue to seek forgiveness becomes our being. You need not do any ritual. The breath comes in and goes out effortlessly. All you need to do is be aware of this. Be a witness as the breath comes in and then goes out. In the beginning it will be hard. As you continue, you will get the knack of it. Remember, meditation is a knack. Unlike other disciplines, it cannot be taught. All a master can do is to create an energy field so that you can get the pulse or the knack of it. In my book, Meditation, the Way to Self-Realization, various techniques of meditation has been explained. And a brief review of the 112 techniques of Vigyan Bhairav Tantra also been mentioned. The first is Hosh Dardam, conscious breathing.